Hello, folks, and welcome to the Vertigo Tea Party, and let's try The Vanishing of Ethan Carter. It's developed by The Astronauts. It's available now on Steam or GOG. You can buy it for $19.99. It's on Windows. It also supports Steam trading cards and has partial controller support. Now, I hopped right in because the area that I wanted to start didn't have a save point. So, anyway, the very first thing I want to say, this is a supernatural investigation type game. You find these crime scenes. You investigate the area, find out what happens, piece together the what happened, and then move on. Now, there's things that aren't necessarily related to the story, or I guess I should say, things you don't have to do. I'm actually skipping one right now, and this is going to be a somewhat relatively short let's try, because I don't want to spoil things. This game is very narrative, very story-driven, and I don't want to give too much away. We're going to be solving one, it's not really a case, it's a part of a case, a crime, if you will. And obviously that's going to be spoiled, but this is literally the first minute of the game. So it's not going to be a whole lot, but there are things over there that you could find that will give you more information on the story. But just wait for this little monologue.
Red Creek Valley seemed like a quiet, ordinary place. I've learned two things in my life. No place is truly quiet. And nowhere is really ordinary. Ethan warned me about that. Warned me not to be fooled by what I saw here. He didn't need to worry. I'd worked dozens of cases, hundreds. This would be my last one.
So as the narrator slash us just stated, we were basically written a letter by this Ethan Carter, who might have something to do with the name of the title. Maybe. But apparently he's gone missing, and we're here to find him and find out what has happened to this boy named Ethan Carter. Now, as far as you can tell, or as far as I can tell, and you can run, by the way, I'm just walking for dramatic effect. But as far as I can tell, you're either some kind of supernatural investigator or some kind of author of the supernatural who also does investigations. It's kind of hard to tell. Also, let me get this out of the way. I notice there's some juddering when I do this. During recording, this does not happen during gameplay. So if you guys are seeing some kind of judderiness or jitteriness or whatever while you're watching, that is the recording software, not the game. I apologize about that. But I did not experience that while playing. Very important. So let's hop right in the train here. We have a forward and a back. But it doesn't do anything, which not surprising given the apparent age and mechanical condition of this device. So let's look around it here. Oh, you need to inspect this. Click on it. Blood. Is it animal or human? Was it an accident or was it murder? Also, there should be a crankshaft here, but that's missing. There's fresh scratches, so it was recently used. Now, this is one of the first mechanics of the game. Whenever you're finding, you know that there should be an object related to the crime scene. You'll get this kind of dialogue with the words kind of floating around. Now, you'll notice, too, when I'm getting in certain areas, the words get a little bit closer together, and then sometimes they spread apart. That's kind of showing you the direction that it is. And once you get it pretty close, you'll see this, and I can press and hold, which I screwed up. Of course, you can always do it again if you're a screw-up like me. They will open kind of a visual portal to show you where the item is, and it's going to scroll around. Now, I'm not controlling this at all. The game decides how it's going to show you this. Now, we can look around. There's a dam over there. Obviously, it looks like it's by a lake. To the left, it could be an island, possibly. It's hard to tell. Just another part of land. Also, kind of want to look around. We're going to get a good idea where this object is, based on what the game shows us. Again, we can't really control it. Now, if we look at the top left, we can kind of see a path. So, it looks like there might be a path down to the lake. And if we can find that path, we can find the crank, which is going to be pretty important, I think. Visually, as you can probably tell, other than the jitteriness that I get from, you know, playing it or recording it, the game looks great. I really like the colors, the background sounds, the wind blowing, the trees and the grass gently swaying. It has a really nice ambience to the game. But as you progress, and even at the beginning, it's kind of creepy. You feel very alone out here. And it's just very, very kind of a dark mood. And it's going to get darker, as you'll soon see. Very, very soon. So you found this rope. Obviously, something's going on with that. So let's inspect it. Looks like the ties were cut. These sides were untied. but there's no blood. So obviously who or what was ever tied here probably did not get killed on the railing. So we move down. Uh-oh, looks like we got a little accident here. A little bit of blood, and that would appear to be legs without a body. So let's inspect. Where's the rest of the corpse? There's a blood trail going that way. The victim, was he dragged away or did he crawl away while he was still alive? Well, let's follow the most obvious thing here. Follow the blood trail down this path. And it looks like we found our man. He is beyond questioning, at least questioning in the normal sense. Let's inspect him. Blood from the legs, blood from something else. There's a fractured skull. We can kind of zoom in here. What was the cause of death? Was it the blood loss from the legs, or was it due to the head trauma? Now let's touch and hold the body, because, you know, that's what weird paranormal investigators do. Now you'll notice here, we kind of open up a little blue shimmering portal, but it doesn't get very large. This game does not explain very much. And that's a minor issue I have with it, is that, what does that mean? Now, given that what you said at the beginning of the game, the beginning of what your character said, you're an investigator, you've investigated hundreds of cases. You've probably investigated cases doing things like this, using your supernatural abilities. So you should know what that means. You should understand that when the portal opens, what that means. And I'll tell you what it means, it's not really a spoiler. What that means is, we haven't finished gathering evidence. We haven't recreated the crime scene completely yet. And once we do, we need to go back. But the game doesn't tell you that. And it's not a big thing, it's not a big hidden thing that you couldn't figure out. But I feel like it should have explained that a little bit better. For example, the narrator there could have said something like, I haven't completely pieced together what's happened. I need to come back when I found more evidence, or whatever. The other thing is, maybe the developers were just being obtuse. Maybe they're being obfuscating it on purpose. My problem with that is, if you've watched the game dev video that covers this area, they talk all about exactly what that mechanic is. So it's not like they have a problem telling you what it is or how it works. They just didn't do it in the game. And I think that's kind of crappy. It's a very minor complaint, but I still think it's kind of weak. It really should have been explained better in the game, especially since your character would have understood it. Anyway, so we found here, we have some brown grass here amongst the green grass. Let's inspect it. There's some dried grass. There's no sun. Looks like it should be getting plenty of sun. There's a rectangular shape. Is it the rail car from the bridge? So here we need another object. We already know this one's out this way. We'll go ahead and peek at it. Yes, we know where the rail car is. Or do we? Actually, I think we do. We also found a gas can here. Gasoline or diesel fuel? It was dropped carelessly, or were they in a rush? Was it dropped on purpose? Were they maybe trying to start a fire here? And burn the rail car to the ground. Unfortunately, our criminal was incredibly stupid. So let's go ahead and investigate down here. Did we find anything else of interest? Inspect. We found a bunch of rocks and a rock-shaped indention with fresh dirt, indicating that, looks like somebody took a rock from there. Press and hold. We know it's this way. We see it's by kind of a cut-down tree stump, and it's right by the railroad track. And can we see the body or anything, or the blood stain? Maybe that would help us find it a little bit easier. No. But I think we're okay. Now, you might be asking, why are you showing us the very beginning of the game? And I think I kind of touched on this earlier. But part of that is because this is a very story-driven game. And a lot of it is finding out what's going on, finding out the mystery of what's going on. And I'm trying to keep spoilers to a minimum. And in fact, I'm going to kind of wrap up my thoughts before I do the very last part of this that shows what happened exactly in this scenario, to kind of give you a wrap up so you can skip it if you don't want to get spoiled. But I feel like this game is very much finding out what's going on your own, discovering it yourself, going in as blind as possible. So I want to show you, the very first case. I keep calling it a case. I'm just going to call it a case. The very first mini case, just so you can understand the mechanics without giving a whole lot away. I have played about 2 hours or so. So it looks like we found the rock. Let's pick it up. We can move it with the mouse. We can zoom in with right click. We can also zoom in while we're not picking up an object, by the way. This looks like the point of impact with something, possibly the skull. Because we do remember that body had a serious head wound. So the rock very well could have been what caused that. So the very next thing we want to do is we need to find that crank. Actually, you know what? Before we do that, actually, let's go find the crank first. We know it was by the lake, and this looks like a path down to the lake, so we'll run down here. There's no limit to stamina. You can run as much as you want, which I like. Also, I don't know if you can die in this game. There is, as far as I know, no combat, no guns, no weapons. It's not like Resident Evil or anything like that. It looks like we found our spot, and here's our crank. And if you'll notice, there's some red paint on the end, or could it be blood? Let's go ahead and take that crank. All right, so one of the things that they don't really explain in this game, which again, I don't consider to be a spoiler, it's more of a basic mechanic that you kind of need to understand in order to progress, is that you need to kind of recreate the crime scene, kind of put the crime scene back together the way it was when the crime, or when the event, I guess I should say, occurred. So we're going to put this rock back to where it came from. And now we think it came from to the far side of the track. So we're going to go and see if it fits over there. Now, I wish you could compare it to his head wound, but our detective, or whatever he is, we're just going to call him a detective, doesn't seem to be, he seems to know the basics, but isn't, like, I guess his analysis of the body isn't complete. Like, he doesn't say, this looks like a large blunt object or a sharp object. It's just head trauma. Which is neither really good or bad. You know you've done something good because it makes that little sound. Let's go see if we can actually investigate, or we can get more information from this body just yet. Oh, we saw the hole get bigger, but it's not all the way yet. So the next thing, let's go try this crank in the train. Now, one thing I wanted to say, because I actually recorded all of this before, then I kind of didn't mention this, and I think it's important to mention. This part of the game where you're picking up objects, it's telling you where to go pick those objects up, recreating the crime scene, and all the parts that we're going to cover in this video aren't everything there is to do. I think it's the main portion from what I've seen, but it's not the entire game. Let's go ahead and crank the train up here. We'll hop on in. Again, any jittering you see from when I'm moving around is the recording, not the game. I definitely did not experience that while playing. So let's go ahead and go back. I will say the graphical look, I really like it, as I've mentioned. I will say, though, that it's a little muddied, but I think they did that on purpose. We need to get this back to where it was. That's where the body is. We actually need to take it back to where it was originally. So I'm going to see if I can see the gas can. I don't think that I can. No pun intended. So I usually end up, oh, there's the leaking of the gas. The other times I just kind of guessed. So let's get out. We don't need to turn the train off for any reason, as far as I can tell. And we know we did good because it made the scary wah noise. So let's go see what the body tells us now, if anything. Here we go. Looks like we found all the clues. Now, these little blue things, I think, are supposed to represent the spirit's last memories, its final memories before it passed. Or at least its perceptions of what was going on at the time. We kind of wait for those things to land, and it creates these little blue flares. When we go to the blue flares, we'll see what that spirit remembers at that instant in time. So here we see what is most likely the last thing it remembers, with him on the ground, legless, in a pool of his own blood, with a strange old man hovered over him. And if you look, sure enough, he's got the crank in his hand. But you'll also notice there's no blood on the crank handle yet. And you'll also notice he has no head wound. Let's go to this other blue flare. We approach it. And now we see the old man. We see the guy without legs, and we see a child. I wonder who that could be. Again, he has the crank. Now, and the reason I'm pointing this out is a lot of times these things are very important. And you'll see as we get to the next phase of this investigation why that's the case. So now we back this. We got the train in position. See the old man. And we see this guy. Now, there's another important thing to note here. Notice he's got the rock now. He doesn't have the crank. He has the rock. Interesting. So let's go over here to where we found the rock. We got another soul flare. I'm going to call it soul flares because it sounds really important. It looks like he's either picking the rock up or putting it back in. Given that we didn't find the rock in place, I think it's a relatively safe bet that he was picking it up at the time. But yeah, one thing I want to point out while we're doing this is something I missed in the last video, is that this isn't all you do. This isn't just a series of doing this over and over, at least from what I've seen so far. Looks like he's just, kneeling, thinking really hard on the train tracks. Probably not the smartest thing. And now we have this. We have that boy we saw over there, which I presume it is to be tied to the tracks. Now, the question you have to ask yourself here is this person helping him get off the tracks, or did he put him there? Good question. Now, you'll notice that once I found this last one, it says chronology, tag. Now we need to tag these in order that they happen. And then you watch the series of events play out and see if it was correct. And it doesn't... You can do this wrong and it doesn't mess you up. You can do it as many times as you want. I think it would have been more... And I'm just going to tag these randomly just to show you what happens when you get it wrong. But I think it would have been interesting, though kind of scary, especially when you can't save the game whenever you want, to let you do it in the wrong order and come to your own conclusions. Say, well, I think it happened this way. And the game goes, okay, well, here's how it could have played out if it played out in the order you said that it played out. That would have been interesting. It could probably have been very frustrating to some people that you could have just completely screwed up the order. And that's not really what this game is going for. It doesn't help that I've been playing Sherlock Holmes, the new Sherlock Holmes game, lately, where you can do that, where you can reach the wrong conclusions based on the evidence that you're given. So it's a little unfair assessment, I think, that I'm making against the game. But I think it still would be interesting. But like I said, at the same time, it feels a little more relaxing because if you screw it up, it's not like, well, this is what you said happened. Move on to the next thing. So anyway, so now that we've got them all marked, we can hit space to visualize in the order that I placed them, and then we'll see if we're right.
Listen to me. We can destroy it. I know how.
You can't destroy it, Ethan. You can't destroy time. And that's what he is. He is forever.
Alright, so it played the first one, so the first one was okay. But when I went to play the second one, it kind of fizzled out, it burned out. So obviously it's not correct. So I need to relook and see the first one is okay. Now, one thing I just noticed here is that last time I picked a different one to be number one, and it still played out. So I think if events are happening at the same time, I think it's okay to pick them to both be number one, which is interesting find, I think. Unless it just always plays number one, which I don't think that's the case. In fact, just to test that, we can walk up to it. Okay. So because it doesn't have a question mark, we know this one happened first. Gotcha. But it looks like some things can happen first if they're happening simultaneously, if that makes sense. So I'm going to kind of wrap up my thoughts on the game quickly. Before I do these in the right order, I'll also kind of give you guys a chance to figure it out yourself. But I kind of want to talk about the rest of the game because, again, I don't want to show off a lot because I think a lot of this game is figuring things out for yourself and seeing it play out. That's the reward you get from this game. It's not like other games, your reward is you leveled up or you get this really sweet piece of equipment or something like that. It's, oh, I figured this case out before the game even told me. At least that's where I get a lot of my reward. I enjoy looking at the items. I like analyzing each item. For example, that crank. The game didn't say, hey, there's blood on the handle of this crank. I noticed it myself. So then I went to think, okay. Was this crank on the train when it hit the person? And then I went to go look at the train. And this is a little bit of a spoiler. But when I look at the train itself, in fact, well, I guess we can't because this is like the past train. Yeah, this is before the blood was on it. If you look at the train up there, the blood does not spatter over here. It stops over here somewhere. So I knew that the handle wasn't on the train when it hit the person that it hit. So I love stuff like that. And then when you see it play out, it feels very rewarding to go, yes, I figured that out. Or I figured out most of that myself and the game didn't handhold me and didn't tell me that. I love that aspect of the game. But the big thing I wanted to say is, one, this isn't the whole game. You don't just find evidence, piece things together, and then move on to the next thing. If you just do the main areas, yes, I think that's possible. I think the main parts of the story I'll have you do pretty much this or something like it. But there's side areas, like I mentioned earlier on, that I completely skipped that don't really, you don't have to do, but you're rewarded with more story. When you're playing a game like this, you have to keep in mind, and I'm just going to kind of look, keep looking at the scenes, you guys can figure out the order yourself. But when you play a game like this, at least in my opinion, a lot of people who enjoy this type of game enjoy it, again, not because of tangible rewards like a better gun or a new talent or a mount or whatever. It's figuring things out, putting the puzzle together in your head, and before the game tells you, figuring out what's happening, creating what you think is happening in the story. To me, that's very, very rewarding, and I feel like the people who would enjoy this game are the people who like that. If you're the type who wants the story totally spelled out, you don't really want to waste time or use time on side puzzles, side missions, figuring stuff out, putting things together, going, okay, well, this postcard has this date on it and was sent to this person from this person in this year, and this newspaper clipping says this. If you're not really into that, then you're probably not going to be that interested in the story, and I don't know how much enjoyment you would get out of this game. But if you're the type like me who does, I think you'll very much, very much enjoy this. This part of the game is definitely interesting. I like figuring out the chronology of how the crime played out and then watching it play out. But the other side things are fun too. And just to kind of give you an explanation, there was another house that was completely off the beaten path. Well, not completely, but partially off the beaten path. And I figured a puzzle out. It took me a while. I did the puzzle. And then I was rewarded, again, I was rewarded with more story, more background, more information about Ethan, and more information about, I keep wanting to say Vanishing of Ethan Hawk, but and more about all the characters, all the story, all the, like, the weird things going on in this town that's causing these terrible things to happen. You figured that out, and you wouldn't catch that if you only do the main missions, and I really like that. And that's just the part that I wanted to accentuate or underline, that this isn't the only part of the game. And on the overall, I think you should play this if you like this kind of stuff. So anyway, I babbled enough. Hopefully you guys have figured out the order. We're going to do it ourselves now, just so you can see how it plays out in game. You can, if you get these orders wrong, or even if you don't, you can just go back to them and press certain keys and put them in the correct order. This probably happens third. I say probably as if I don't know. All right, so now we think we've got them in order. This is space, and let's see how it plays out. Let's see if we get it right.
Listen to me. We can destroy it. I know how.
You can't destroy it, Ethan. You can't destroy time. And that's what he is. He is forever.
Gale, honey, I wish there was another way.
Travis, tell me where Ethan is, now.
I'm giving the sleeper what he wants, what all of us want. Look, old man, you need to go home.
Close your eyes.
And there you have it. Now there's some other small inferences that you can pick up from that. So for example, even though this guy tried to kidnap Ethan, well, it did kidnap and tried to kill him. Obviously, the old man didn't want to do this. He said something about, you know, he didn't wish he didn't have to do it this way when he picked the rock. And then he told him to close his eyes when he was basically finishing him off. Obviously, not somebody he hates unquestioningly. So there's definitely more to it. And again, I love trying to catch those little subtleties and putting things together myself. I absolutely love that kind of thing, and those of you who enjoy that should enjoy this game. Now, let's talk about some of the negative things. I've talked almost entirely about the positives. Let's talk about the negatives. I wish you could focus a little bit better on items. So, for example, and this is kind of grisly, but I wish you could zoom in more on the body. Like, I wish you could kind of scan around the body, look at the wounds, check out the clothes, check out the blood splatters, things like that to get a more in-depth look on, you know, and try to put together the picture yourself. There's some cases where your character kind of mentions something, but it's very hard to see it because you can't zoom into it. And that's kind of an issue sometimes, not always, but sometimes. I also wish you kept a notebook. There's no notebook of any kind. And a lot of times you'll find things like a written story or a news article, and there's nowhere that stores that. You just kind of have to remember it. Somebody like me who has a really terrible memory, but at the same time wants to figure out what's going on and wants to put the puzzle together yourself, the puzzle of the story yourself. At no point in the game do I think it's going to say, okay, you beat the game. Here's everything that happened. Here's all the background of the story. I think it's one of those games you kind of have to put that together yourself. And again, somebody with a memory like mine, it's very hard to remember all that. It would be nice to have a notepad to kind of go back over the clipping and say, oh, I remember finding that like 3 hours ago. That ties into this thing. And now that explains why this person was doing this. I wish they would have kept up with that kind of stuff. There are other things. And this is going to seem nitpicky, but you have to keep in mind, this is a game that's like an investigation game where you're trying to look for subtle clues, like the brown grass over here that's over here. So you're going to be looking at very minute details often, especially, again, if you really like to get into that whole I'm an investigator, I'm Sherlock Holmes aspect. And there are a couple of times, not very frequently, like I'm talking once or twice, where I thought, okay, that's weird. This doesn't make any sense. And I'm not going to give any spoilers, but for example, let's say that there was blood here where he got his legs cut off and he obviously crawled over here. But let's say there was no blood anywhere from here all the way to there. That would not make any sense, right? Like, at a real crime scene, that wouldn't be the case. He also probably wouldn't have lost quite this blood, much blood, and actually would have been still alive, but we'll ignore that for now. There was like one area in particular that I'm thinking of where something similar happened, and I was a little disappointed. I was like, well, that doesn't seem realistic that's the case, because it just doesn't make sense. But for the most part, they do a good job of that. Other things don't make a lot of sense either. For example, the guy got hit with a rock way down here. He runs all the way up here. After getting hit in the head with a rock, he kind of just hangs out here on the tracks, waits for the old guy to run him over. So after he gets his legs cut off, he goes all the way down here before he, and while still alive. So that doesn't make a hell of a lot of sense. It's kind of needed, given the type of game it is, where you're having to find different, physically, geographically different locations and then piece together the chronology of what happened. So I'm willing to kind of look past that, but it does kind of stick out to me. When I'm looking in the case, I'm often like, well, how did that person get way over here? Does that make sense? But for the most part, I overlook it, because so far I've really been interested in the story. I've really been interested in finding out exactly what's happened. I love the ambience. Graphically, musically, the ambient sounds, the trees and the wind blowing constantly. I think it just creates a really great, spooky environment. And I've just very much been enjoying this game. In fact, I plan on finishing this game. Maybe not necessarily a Let's Play, but I want to finish this game off camera. And for me, that's saying a lot, because I let's try a lot of games. And most of them, even if I like them okay, I don't really like them enough to finish them or play them a whole lot afterwards, just because I have so many other games to play. This one, I absolutely want to finish, because I want to find out what happens, and I really enjoy the investigation aspect. So anyway, that's enough babbling on about Vanishing of Ethan Carter. Again, it's $19.99 on Steam or GOG. All relevant links will be in the description below the video. I meant to mention I did get a review copy of this game ahead of time, just like I do with most other games. But yeah, I absolutely, totally dig this game. Highly suggest it if you enjoy the investigation aspects and figuring out the story yourself and putting the pieces together. Absolutely check out this game, especially for $19.99. Thank you guys for watching. Make sure to leave video or make sure to leave comments in the description below the video. Let me know what you thought of this game. If you'd like to see more games like this or more videos like this where I cover games you might not have heard of, make sure to subscribe. Follow me on Twitter, and I'll see you next time.
Step back, though. We are getting this worked up about a mobile game. I mean,
I do hate you, though. I want to be 100% clear with a moment of seriousness. I hate your guts.